Thank you, Catherine and Dorothy. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to a brisk Sunday morning at Cleveland Park Congregational United Church of Christ. We are an open and affirming congregation, so whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey and your personal faith journey, you're always welcome here. We love to have visitors. If you're visiting today in the sanctuary, there's a sign-in sheet in the entryway. We'd love to hear from you. And if you are on Zoom, there is a visitor link in the chat. Also, remember if you're on Zoom to mute your devices, and in the sanctuary, please remember to mute your phones. A couple of quick announcements. Most importantly, the racial justice conversation that was scheduled for after church today has been postponed because of Pastor Ellen's absence. So that will be rescheduled at a later date. A reminder too in your bulletin about the Thanksgiving gift cards. We'd love to have those from local grocery stores in $40 denominations. And you can drop those off in the mailbox, or you can mail them this week, or you can bring them next Sunday. Poetry Hour, of course, resumes next week. And I'll have updates on other events as we get closer to them. So with that, I will turn it over to Callie.
Good morning, church. We begin this morning's worship by lighting our candles of hope and healing for the world. The theme of today's service is dreaming. Please join me in the call to worship. My God, you have searched me and known me. It was you who formed my inward parts, knit me together in my mother's womb. Please join together in our opening prayer. Creator God, source of all, you know who we are, and we are each a work in progress. When we make plans, life happens, and it's clear we are not in control. Help us release our need to manage outcomes. Let us succumb to the touch of your potter's hand. Open us to the language of dreaming, the possibility of all that can be. Reassure us that trust is a powerful tool, and imagination can lead to redemption. Amen. I invite you to please rise in body or spirit for our opening hymn, Womb of Life and Source of Being, which can be found on page 14 of your chalice hymnal.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I now invite you to join in a time of silent reflection. When we gather for worship, we heed God's call and honor our need for Sabbath and rest. When we enter into silence, we attune our hearts and open our minds to a presence greater than our own. As we begin this short period of meditation, I encourage you to bring your full self to this present moment. Set aside any distractions, lay down your burdens, and take a deep, life-giving breath. God is with us. Let us reflect upon the week that has passed. What are the joys we have celebrated? And what concerns have we endured? Are there things we have done that we ought not to have done? And are there things we have left undone that we ought to have done? As we look forward to the week ahead, what help will we need from God or neighbor? And what can we do to nurture the love of God and love of neighbor in the world? We'll close in prayer. Source of life, for the joys we have celebrated, we give you thanks. God of compassion, for the concerns we have endured, please tend our hearts. Spirit of justice, for those things we have misdone, transform us with your love. Companion God, as we look forward to the week ahead, be ever present with us. And great lover of all, as we seek to nurture love of God and neighbor in the world, guide our actions and our prayers. Amen. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Rest, and be assured that through the grace and love of God, you are, I am, we are forgiven. Though we have each done things we ought not to have done, and have left undone things we ought to have done, we are assured of the forgiveness through the awesome and redemptive power of God's great mercy and love. We are loved by a God of so, so many names, the greatest of which is love. And now, held in the arms of this God, who is Father and Mother and parent of us all, we pray together the prayer of Jesus, our brother, saying together, Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I now invite all those online to unmute and those in the sanctuary to share the peace and love of God with their neighbor in the pew. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you, everyone. Good to see you.
Peace be with everyone.
Happy birthday, Mom.
Peace be with you all. Happy birthday to Ellen tomorrow.
Thank you, Mom. Peace be with you all.
And happy birthday to her brother today.
Right. My fifth birthday present.
Yeah.
Yeah. I also got a really cool set of handmade doll clothes by my mom.
Very cool.
You'll have to tell me about that, Al.
Wonderful. All right. So good to see you all. Let's see. Is Bella here?
Bella is actually not here this morning because she is sick. And so I will make the announcement with my lovely tenor/bass voice. Anyway, Bella, unfortunately, we just found out very early this morning that she was sick. And so she will not be able to do the children's time this morning. So we're inviting children who are in the sanctuary to go downstairs because Ella, not Bella, but Ella, our nursery caregiver, would be very happy to have anyone come down with her, or of course, they're always welcome to stay in the service. And we wish Bella rapid healing. Thank you all for your patience during this time of cold, flu, and COVID.
Thank you for the update, Ellen. And actually, now that I'm looking around, I don't know that we actually have any littles we have one so little, even on my little short person stool I couldn't see. Okay, well, please feel welcome and invited to go downstairs at any point if you'd like to. All right, at this moment I would invite Margaret up to get off today's scripture reading.
Good morning. Our first reading this morning comes from Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 through 6, the potter and the clay. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Come, go down to the potter's house and there I will let you hear my words. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. Can I not do for you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. Our second reading is from Luke chapter 14, verses 25 to 33, the cost of discipleship. Now, large crowds were traveling with him, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions."
Thank you so much, Margaret. I'll wait and make sure that I can be heard.
Can people hear me?
Okay, thank you. So it's really good to, see those of you online. I can see those of you online easily. And it's also good to sort of see, based on the camera view, those of you in the congregation. It's actually a nice opportunity for me to, for the very first time, experience the service from the perspective of those of you who are online. And Callie, thank you so much for your, as always, beautiful job of leading worship. It's actually really special to be on this side of things. So I'm not quite as much of a baritone as I was earlier this week. And I am certainly starting to feel better, though still testing dramatically positive. But I do want to say, in addition to thanking Callie, one of the bonuses of being on this side of the screen between 10 and 10:30 is you can sort of see everybody scurrying around in the sanctuary, and the tech folks did a sound check with me, and I'm not sure exactly who did the beautiful pumpkins and gourds and fall decorations on our communion table, but those are just so beautiful. And, it really does take a village every Sunday morning. And so as much as I'm going to be preaching, to a certain degree about the importance of rest today, I also really value and am so grateful for the labor that many of you contribute to all that makes our church the wonderful place that it is. So thank you. And then just one PSA before I start, and that is, I am fully vaccinated, meaning I have my two initial vaccinations, my two boosters, and my bivalent booster. And I still got pretty darn sick this week. So I just really want to put it out to folks that while, yes, we do have a mask optional policy at church now, I strongly encourage you to wear your masks and do that for both the safety of yourselves and the people around you, because this virus continues to be no joke. And This year, we also have the bonus of cold and flu season. So not to be a downer, but just to really put my arms out to you all and say, I want you to be as safe as and healthy as possible. So, all right. So having done my PSA and my gratitudes, I will now move to my sermon. When I went on sabbatical last spring, I told myself and you that it was time for something different. I wanted to pull back on my executive director role and prioritize the pastoral. Well, after returning this fall, I can say both because of the way I'm constructed and how our church is organized, it's harder than I thought. Of course, we operate in the same manner as most churches of majority white mainline denominations, so we're not different, but that means we're set up kind of like a charitable organization, a 501c3 or NGO. Our bylaws refer to officers and trustees, and we run official meetings according to Robert's Rules of Order. Now, I'm not criticizing this way of doing things. It was created to help organizations run more smoothly, efficiently, productively. And in churches, it's typically been balanced by an emphasis on prayerful deliberation and a true desire to discern and follow God's will. The problem is, as architects know, function follows form. And when faith communities are formed in the image of more business-like organizations, they tend to function according to those norms. Thus, rather than offering a transformative challenge to the status quo values of overwork and achievement, we follow in their footsteps. Now, to be fair, it's hard for us to see the systems in which we live. We're so accustomed to the way things are, it's difficult to imagine how they might otherwise be. It's the water in which we swim, the very air we breathe. Perhaps this is why Jesus spoke so radically, so boldly, so frighteningly in passages like the one we heard from Luke's gospel this morning. Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. None of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. Did he really want us to leave our families, abandon our children? Do we have to give up our homes? Leave everything we love behind in order to follow him? I don't know. But this passage challenges me to listen hard. And what I hear is that we must be willing to give up our attachments, whatever they may be, whatever is holding us back from being free. If we want to follow Jesus, we must be willing to give up that which burdens us. The shackles to which we become so accustomed, they're now comfortable. Because shackles aren't what God wants for us. The systems, operations, bylaws, and cultural givens on which we've come to depend may not be the vessel God intends for us. Perhaps Jesus, like Jeremiah, is suggesting we take our clay, smush it, and put it back on the potter's wheel, ready for a new form, one that isn't comfortable, familiar, efficient, productive, reliable, or even safe. One that takes us in new directions, emboldens us to let go of old rules, challenges us to live together in different ways, and allows us to see ourselves in new light. This summer, the following question came to me. What is the point of church at this particular moment in the 21st century? I mean, if you're looking for community, there are plenty of organizations and clubs. Good music, ample venues, conversation, plenty of book and discussion groups, especially in DC. If church is to be relevant, to really matter, it needs to be different. To offer a place to practice living in new ways, counter to the culture at large. If we're to be a transformative presence in this neighborhood, community, city, or even in our own parlor, we must engage in creating the table-turning paradigm of God's beloved community. Not just another well-run bureaucracy with better than average intentions. Now, please understand, I am not saying we're the latter, but I think with grace and creativity and a little courage, we could shift powerfully in the direction of the former. Last week, three things happened. I went to Cambridge. I met with Callie. I got COVID. I'll start with Cambridge, where I had a truly wonderful weekend at the Divinity School. The first morning, I went to a service and heard these words from a North African chant. My soul misses me. My entire body resonated, and I felt a longing at once infinitely sweet and unbearably sad. I wondered, how do we remain connected to our source, our core vitality, our true selves, God's call? How can we respond to this call in such a way that energizes rather than enervates us? The day after I returned, I met with Callie to talk about lay leadership, and she showed me Tricia Hersey's new book, Rest is Resistance. Not rest as resistance, rest is resistance. Hersey is a Black woman who created the Knapp Ministry, which promotes the idea that rest itself is a revolutionary response. In her words, capitalism was created on plantations during chattel slavery and is the same system that is driving the entire globe to exhaustion and a deep disconnection with our bodies and minds today. She continues, rest pushes back and disrupts a system that views human bodies as a tool for production and labor. It is a counter-narrative. To quote Callie, not doing is normal, healthy, good, life-giving, and trustworthy. Words which may have been prescient, since the next day I tested positive for COVID and was forced, perhaps by my own soul, who missed me, to slow down and rest. Of course, you could point out, and you'd be right, that I still wrote this sermon and am preaching this morning. And others might add, I attended Zoom meetings and wrote and answered emails while sick, which is true. Because I'm nowhere near there yet. I'm nowhere near trusting that it's okay to slow down, or even safe to do so. I'm so much a product of this capitalist, white supremacist, patriarchal culture that I still see my worth in terms of how much I can produce. I'm not proud of this, though I used to be, so I suppose that's progress. It's just how it is. The air we breathe, the water in which we swim. The good news is that I truly believe it's possible for us to imagine our way into something different, more life-affirming, that our souls can collectively celebrate. Audre Lorde wrote, "You can't dismantle the master's house with the master's tools." And she was right. We can't create the beloved community with the same backbreaking, soul-crushing structures and systems used for so long to oppress people who are female, Black, Indigenous, LGBTQ, disabled, or in any other way don't fit our narrowly defined cultural norms. We need new ways of living and being. And church can be the place we practice. Church can be the community in which we try and fail and succeed and try again. Friends, I'm a beginner. As many years as I've written, preached, and talked about challenging and changing the system, slowing down, doing things differently, I'm still entrenched. I learned well the lesson that doing, or shall I say, overdoing, was a way to keep myself and everyone I love safe. And so I've done and done and done. But it's not true. We don't stay safe by overfunctioning. We don't find salvation by accomplishing more. We don't keep all the scary monsters at bay by being ever more efficient and productive. So yes, I'm a beginner. And I'm taking baby steps. I'm learning to like not knowing. I'm starting to feel excited about our congregation dreaming together with no idea what's next. I'm taking the pause and wondering what God has in store, even enjoying the idea of being a lump of clay thrown on a potter's wheel. I'm feeling energized by the possibility of letting go. Sometimes. Other times, yeah, I'm just scared. So what do you think? Is it time to take a step back as a congregation and reimagine what sort of vessel we're meant to be? Do we have the capacity to take a long, deep breath and enter an intentional process of dreaming and discovery quite different from our usual mode of planning and procedure? Would we like to do things differently? Which may sometimes mean doing nothing at all. Do we want to practice living a new way? Is this what our church could be? Today, I won't say amen, which means so be it. I'll say instead, let's see. I invite you to rise in body or spirit for our sermon hymn.
Thank you.
Ellen, beautiful sermon. Church, beautiful song. It is now the time in our service when we share our deep joys and concerns, silently or out loud, with God and with one another. I'll share those we've already received, and if I can ask for an assist from up top for any posted in the chat, we'll then invite those in the sanctuary to share. God, hear our healing prayers for Sam, who yesterday tore his Achilles, for Harold's shoulder injury, for Barb G, who's in rehab after experiencing a stroke, for Jane's friend Mike, who lives with a terminal illness. With the help of his wife and close friends, Mike has produced 4 remarkable Zoom presentations on the Chartres Cathedral, a place he has loved and studied for decades. We pray for friends and family of our congregation who are managing long-term health concerns and diagnoses. And we pray for our dear Ellen as she recovers from COVID. God, hear our prayers for Ellen P's friend Carol, who lost her son 2 years ago and whose daughter has progressive metastasized cancer. For Jane's friend Tammy, whose father is in hospice. For people all over the world who are dealing with the aftermath of storms and flooding. For friends and family of our congregation who are grieving the loss of loved ones. And for anyone, anywhere, who is sick or grieving or in need. God, we give thanks for peaceful and democratic elections, for Lee and her warm, open-hearted presence, for the great turnout last week at our recent dinner and a movie evening, and the chance to be in community with one another. I invite anyone in the congregation who wishes to share a joy or a concern to raise your hand, and please wait for the mic. Serena will bring it to you so that those worshiping online can hear you as well.
Prayers for the friends and family of my friend Tim, who died unexpectedly last week, and prayers of healing for my mom, who has Rocky Mountain spotted fever.
Prayers for my uncle who died yesterday and for my cousins who lost their second parent yesterday.
Prayers for my colleague Stacy, whose son is recovering from a suicide attempt.
We certainly hold all of these concerns in prayer. Are there any other concerns or joys that we would like to share together? Okay. Mark, are there any posted online in the chat? No, okay. Well, let us take a moment of silence to hold these joys and concerns. Let us pray. Loving God, listen to the prayers of your people. Comfort and nourish us in both our joys and our concerns, spoken or unspoken, and hold us tenderly as we face the many different experiences that life and being human can bring. Holy and gracious Spirit, we are grateful for your presence as we move into this new week. A time that will bring forth its own sorrows and joys. Remind us to hold one another in love and prayer, reaching out as we are able to lend a hand, offer support, or share in celebration. We give thanks for the blessing of this congregation in our lives and pray that we might be a blessing to others in return. In your compassionate name, amen. I invite you to continue holding these joys and concerns in your heart as we listen to Latia sing Brother James Eyre.
If you've already pledged, thank you very much. If you haven't yet, please take some time to prayerfully consider what your donations will be for the year to come. We'd love to get them in as soon as you can send them in. The sooner we get everything in, the easier it is for us to plan the budget for next year. We began stewardship season last Sunday with the first of our series of speakers from the congregation who are sharing what this church means to them and has meant to them. And thank you again to Peg for speaking last week. Today, I'm very delighted to welcome Callie to share her thoughts.
All right. So I began worshiping at EC about 3.5 years ago. I very quickly resonated with the liturgies and the people, but I was hesitant to join as a member too hastily. So I decided that I would wait a full year before making a choice one way or the other. I loved that CPC had a name for me even in this liminal state. I was a friend of the congregation, and I gladly started to read scripture, attend quarterly retreats, and participate in various initiatives of the church. In late fall of that same year, Ellen asked me if I'd like to join the worship committee. I hemmed and hawed a bit. I really did love CPC's worship, and I thought that being on the committee could be a neat way to meet people in a group setting. but my dad is a pastor, and I've consequently been advised to be wary of church bureaucracies. Ellen, being the insightful gem that she is, offered that I could attend a meeting to get a feel for it. No pressure. Well, I went, and if memory serves correctly, by the time the meeting had finished, I had enthusiastically agreed to Advent service with Holly, and I'd given my blessing to add my name to the worship committee roster. As I consider what this congregation means, I come to the opportunity has consistently been a supportive place for me to grow into young adulthood. It was as a member of the worship committee that first introduced meeting agendas and the delegation of tasks. It's also that I've been able to host preaching fellows, create orders of service, and even preach a few times. This is the first space in my young adult life where my intellectual and emotional contributions have been seen, heard, and appreciated. I cannot overstate how validating and affirming that has been. Similarly, as I've come to understand myself clear and friends in this congregation were among the first to hear my fears, my questions, my relief, my pride, this too has been no small encouragement. About 2 months ago, I started working with a new therapist. One of the things I've been able to name is that I don't often feel safe to be angry. Slowly but surely, I am coming to trust that conflict is normal and healthy, and it's perfectly okay, helpful even, to voice frustration. Emotions are conduits for information, and anger arises to inform us that our boundaries are not being respected. It's one thing to know this. It's another thing entirely to actually act upon this truth, especially within family where deep habits have deep, deep grooves, or at work where within a capitalist context you are utterly replaceable if you don't produce sufficiently. But do you know where I've felt safe enough to start to give voice to my frustrations when they arise? Church meetings. Do you know where I've started to respond to requests with no, or I can't do that, but how about this? Church email chains. And do you know how that's been received? With gratitude. And so odd as it sounds on its face, when I consider what CPC means to me, I offer that it is a place where I can practice recognizing and honoring my boundaries, where I can gain confidence that conflict can be engaged in productively and lovingly. It is a place where my penchant for words and for worship and for meaning are received with gratitude. It is a community that holds space for growth and process and grace. It is now the time in our service where we receive the offering in grateful appreciation for the life and work of this beloved community. To support the ongoing work of our church, I ask that you please give in person, via mail, or online as you are able. If you're in the sanctuary, you can contribute as the offering plate is passed. You're also welcome to take out your phone and scan the QR code on the back of your worship bulletin. This will take you to the donate page of our website. If you've already donated, you may take one of the new offering cards in the pew racks and put it in the plate as a symbol of your giving. For those on Zoom, the link to our donate page is in the chat room. And as the plates are being passed, I invite you to take some time to reflect on the gift of this church and its many blessings in our lives. Thank you all for your gifts of time, talent, and treasure. Please be seated as I look at my cheat sheet because I forget what's next. All right, sorry, you could have kept standing. Our closing hymn is Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, which is on page 560. And actually after that, we will remain standing either in body or spirit for our Ellen, do you have a commission?
I am happy to give a commission. I'm happy to give a commission, if you can hear me.
We can hear you, and we'd love your commission, Ellen.
Okay. I should say that I chose this hymn as the closing hymn for today because it was the hymn that we closed our very first online service with in March 2020. And we repeated this hymn a number of times during those pandemic months into years. And I think that I think all of us found strength in the idea that we could lean on not just the everlasting arms, but we could lean on one another. And that that is really so much of what church is. It is that we are a beloved community, and yes, we can become more creative and more different, and we can practice all sorts of new ways. And yes, underneath it all, we are a beloved community of people who are here for one another and who will spread out our arms to catch one another when we fall. And together we'll trust that as a people and as a community and as a world, there is a source greater than us that is also there to hold and catch us whenever we fall. And so this morning, may we go forth together, holding this thought in our hearts. And if our souls are missing us, if you ask yourself the question, does my soul miss me? And there's a part of you that says yes, then ask your soul what it needs. Ask your sweet self, your dear soul, what it needs. And listen. You'll hear an answer. Go in peace.
Peace. Thank you, Ellen. I invite you all to please join in our song benediction.